As we begin today's meeting, we'd like to acknowledge that we're gathering here today on the treaty territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, before them, the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Huron, and Wendat. We acknowledge the First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and other global Indigenous people that now call Brampton their home. We are honored to live, work, and enjoy this land. Before we start today's meeting, I would ask that we pause for a moment to remember those who have passed or are suffering from COVID-19 and to reflect and think of the various frontline workers, healthcare providers, and first responders who are working so hard to serve, protect, and care for all of us. Please rise for the singing of our national anthem, to be followed by a moment of personal reflection. Welcome to our regular council meeting, May 27th. We will begin the meeting with the city clerk calling the roll for attendance at today's meeting.
Members of council, I will call your names. Councillor Santos?
Here.
Councillor Visante?
Here.
Councillor Willens?
Present.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Present.
Councillor Bowman?
Present.
Councillor Medeiros?
Here.
Councillor Williams?
Yes, I'm here.
Councillor Fortini?
I'm here.
Councillor Singh? Councillor Singh?
Here.
Thank you.
Here.
Councillor Dillon?
I'm here.
And Mayor Brown, Mr. Mayor, here. All members are present.
We are now at item 2, the approval agenda. Does any member wish to add a business item to today's meeting? If so, please use the instant messaging section of Skype to add your name to the speakers list. I believe Councillor Bowman is first.
Thank you very much to you, Mr. Mayor. I would like to add a discussion item under new business, I guess 18.2, on the increased level of vehicular speeding and other assorted things to do with the cars in the city.
Okay. Next, Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So members of council, at a subsequent meeting, you supported the referral of proposed bylaw 91-2020. And this was a draft bylaw for the subdivision in Ward 6, south of Mayfield, west of McLaughlin Road. I'm asking that the issues have been resolved, and I'm asking for this to be put back on the agenda. And I'll take the item number because I'll be asking for it to be moved into consent as well.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, the proposed item would be 21.10, bylaw 91-2020. Next is Councillor Medeiros.
Councillor Medeiros.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to add a discussion around Seniors Heritage Month.
Okay. So that would be proposed item 18.3. And next is Councillor Santos.
Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor. I'd just like to add a piece of correspondence from the Downtown Brampton BIA. It's a letter, and it was forwarded over to the clerk.
That would be correspondence 14.3.
Okay. Councillor Fortini?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just wanted to add another discussion on swimming pools, please.
Okay. Councillor Williams? No, I think. No, I guess that's it for. So we have a motion moved by Councillor Dillon, seconded by Councillor Singh to approve the agenda as amended. If there's any objections, please state so now. Otherwise, you'll be recorded as in the affirmative. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. As we continue to persevere in these extraordinary times, Council is now permitted to conduct its meetings electronically to support physical distancing and public gathering restrictions, while ensuring the business of the municipality can continue. Meetings of municipal councils are to be open to the public for transparency and accountability, and our meeting will continue to be as well, with a few precautions and limitations. In-person attendance at this meeting is severely restricted to members of council and some senior staff. Members and most staff are participating electronically in this meeting. The public can still access and participate in the meetings by a few measures. You can watch remotely. You can use the playback and archive video stream on the city's website. You can submit questions to the clerk's office at cityclerksoffice@brampton.ca with your question, which we can read into the record at the 15-minute public question period. Also, continue to follow the important service updates at brampton.ca. A final reminder for members of council before we start to consider today's agenda is please ensure your video is off and your microphone is muted until you are assigned the floor. Then you can turn both on when you speak. This will help ensure only one person is speaking at one time and minimize other background disruptions during the meeting. Item 3, declarations of interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act. Does any member have a declaration of pecuniary interest under the Municipal Conflict of Interest Act for any matter to be considered on today's agenda? Seeing none, the clerk will so note for the meeting minutes. We're now ready to move to the next item of public business on today's council agenda, item 4, minutes. Do any members have questions or comments regarding the minutes? Seeing none, we have a motion moved by Councillor Singh, seconded by Councillor Dillon to approve the minutes as published. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Our next item is the consent motion. The items listed with carrot on the agenda are considered to be routine and non-controversial. The consent motion is to adopt these matters on today's agenda without the need for a separate discussion on the item. If any member wishes to add to the consent item, please add your name to the consent to our instant messaging section of Skype. First up is Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, sir, with that, Mr. Mayor. I'd like to add 2110, the bylaw that was just added into the consent agenda. I'd also like to add 22.1, 22.2. Those are the minutes in the in-camera. And I'd also like to add 22.3, as Councillor Willens and I have no issues with that item into consent. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. I see Councillor Santos is no longer on the consent list. Councillor Bowman, are you on the list as well?
No, sir.
Okay. So we have a motion moved by Councillor Fortini, seconded by Councillor Vicente to approve the consent motion. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries.
So, Mr. Mayor, just for clarity, so with the addition of the closed session business to consent and the approval, the note to file in the minutes are acknowledged and direction is given, and the closed session report direction is given as outlined in the report.
Yes.
So,
yeah. Okay, that takes us to item 6.1. Yes. Our next item is 6.1, an announcement read the National Accessibility Week, May 31st to June 6th. Councillor Fortini, Council's representative on the Accessibility Advisory Committee, will be making today's announcement. Councillor Fortini. Councillor Fortini?
Hello?
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
We can.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, so
On this is National Accessibility Week. It starts on May 31st and until June 6th. And this is an opportunity to recognize individuals and organization committee for the for moving our barriers. We are an inclusive committee, and we strive everyone to have an equal opportunity to work, live, shop, and play here in our city, great city of Brampton. Our term of council priorities also highlight the importance and improving accessibility for people of all ages with a disability and abilities. This helps them more encourage and engage and also in our community. I want to thank the Accessibility Committee for their guidance and vulnerable and ensuring that the city programs and service are available for all people with a disability. The committee has been instrumental in establishing an annual accessibility awards that we have done great work in happening in our community. I want to also include by encouraging everyone to take a moment this week to recognize and give a shout out to the people in our organizations that have been making Brampton more accessibility for everyone in Brampton. So thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Fortini. Councillor Medeiros, would you like to speak to that?
Yes, Councillor Mayor Brown and Peter, I'm not sure if it's appropriate. Just because we're celebrating National Accessibility Week, just in terms of a scorecard, in terms of how we are, because I know from the accessibility legislation, which the province introduced years ago, that Brampton was still working towards meeting all its accessibility requirements and responsibilities. Can we, I'm not sure if it's appropriate to, if staff can come back, and I don't need it now, they can let us know at a later time. How are we doing the, on that regarding, you know, if we were to look at a scorecard, are we 80% compliant? Do we still have more work to do? If we have that information, if that can be brought forward?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, there is a municipal accessibility plan that municipalities put together, and we can bring forward a report in the future on where we're at with that plan.
Yeah, and I'm fine with that. It's just for us to get a sense of how we're doing and if we're continue to comply and just in sort of relative terms with other municipalities, how we're doing on that front. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor Medeiros. So, do we need a motion to receive this?
No.
No, okay. Government Relations Matters, item 7.1. Gurdeep Kaur will give us our latest government relations update. Welcome, Gurdeep.
Thank you, and through the Mayor, in the interest of time, I just want to provide a very quick update on a few items that are not in the presentation, and then I'm happy to answer any questions any members may have at that point. So I'm going to start with Regional Council. Late yesterday, the region circulated presentations to the following agenda items. 8.1, update on demobilization and recovery planning that's aligned with provincial framework and guided by public health expertise and direction. The region is currently in the recovery planning stage, with key considerations being made regarding facilities, leveraging technology, health and safety communications. A further update will be provided in June with initial demobilization and recovery plans. Secondly, I'd like to talk about item 8.2, responding to the COVID-19 outbreak in Peel region, core indicators guide to reopening from the region's interim medical officer of health. This presentation includes next steps, including enhancing testing approaches and addressing sources of transmission in Peel, such as in the large workplace clusters, ongoing spread with large households, and long-term care home outbreak cases. Lastly, I did want to acknowledge that finance staff did provide a few comments regarding item 17.2, funding of capped tax increase 2020. Capping protects property owners when assessment increases result in excessive tax increases. The capping program then utilizes a clawback to fund the revenue shortfall across the region. When an assessment change results in a reduction of taxes, some or all the reduction is withheld to fund the cap. Annually, the tax policy team reviews and analyzes the tax data to determine which properties are affected by capping and clawback and to establish the clawback rates necessary to fund the cap. The tax policy options must be established prior to the calculation of the clawback rates, and those that were set in bylaw by the region 2 weeks ago. Aggressive use of all tax policy options has resulted in only 15 properties. And last item that I'd like to discuss today is a long-term care. Yesterday, the province provided an update regarding the Canadian Forces report on the state of 5 long-term care. That includes Grace Manor in Brampton highlighted the following. The premier admitted the system is broken and everything is on the table to a question about whether long-term care should come back under the province's responsibilities. A full public inquiry is also on the table at this time. The military's report details serious concerns around infection prevention, safety, staffing, and level of care. The Prime Minister also addressed questions on the long-term care in Ontario and across Canada. Thank you. That's all for the updates I have. And if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer at this point.
Are there any questions for Gurdeep? Hearing none, we have a motion from Councillor Pileschi, seconded by Councillor Willens, to receive the report and presentation. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Next item is 8.1, delegations. Public notice was issued by the city regarding the intention to enact a Brampton stormwater bylaw charge. This relates to items 10.5 on today's agenda, a staff report regarding this matter. In place of in-person delegations, written delegations are accepted regarding this matter. I'll ask the clerk if there are any written delegations.
There are none, Mr. Mayor.
There are no written delegations. Seeing none, we can move on to the next business item, and we'll deal with this item in the agenda order. Our next item is 9.1, an update on the COVID-19 emergency. I would like to provide an update to Council. And I should note, first of all, thank you to Councillor Akirat Singh, who helped me with the weekly briefing this morning, along with Dr. Lowe. What I'd like to flag this week in my COVID briefing is that we're still in a pandemic in Brampton. I know there's political pressure in parts of the province to reopen. Those conversations are very premature. The stark reality is we continue to have community spread throughout the GTA, and it tends to be higher in areas where there is multiple family dwelling units, higher level of density. We've had a number of workplace outbreaks as well in Brampton, and so we're still in the thick of this. So with the good weather coming and those that are anxious to see provisions relaxed, don't get too anxious, because we have to put public health first. We have to listen to our medical officer of health first, and to our hospital CAO. I'm on a daily call with Naveed Muhammad and Lawrence Lowe, and their advice is what is driving the direction we're going, the cautious approach. And I think, frankly, Brampton continues to be an example of cautious, a cautious, safe approach to how we handle this. When other cities have reopen sports parks or public parks, and they've seen incidents of large gatherings, we have hesitated to do that here in Brampton, and I think it vindicates our cautious approach. Certainly, if you look what happened at Trinity Bellwoods Park in Toronto on the weekend, it's evidence that our reservation was well warranted. I've been speaking to the Premier about concerns of being one of the GTA hotspots, and then in the need for testing. He has given me his commitment that we're gonna ramp up testing in Brampton, and then it's gonna be open for everyone, regardless if you have symptoms. Testing is one of the means to know where the virus is and how fast it's spreading. I've had a lot of questions about where the hotspots are in our community, and I've spoken to public health and said that I expect that information to be made public. And so they are putting the data together in a format that can be digested and read, and that will be made public shortly. I thought that was important. I think we owe it to the public. Transparency is essential during a pandemic. I'd also note we're starting a campaign with Brampton Transit to wear wear masks on buses. There's going to be a publicity campaign with that effort to make sure everyone is wearing a mask using public transit. I should also note I have written all of our city employees to get tested. This is part of the new provincial language. They want everyone to get tested. And so we wrote our city employees about this on Monday in coordination with our local labor partners. And I was heartened to know that we've got a complete collaboration between our labor leadership and the city leadership. We had the Brampton Professional Firefighters Association, QP Local 831, our local ATU local, all provide quotes in the press release asking for this testing. And so everyone is putting public health first, which I am grateful for. So those are some quick updates in the past week. And once again, grateful how everyone on City Council continues to step up and help make these charitable donations possible, or your work on the task force. Grateful for everyone working on all cylinders, despite the fact we are in a pandemic and City Hall is closed. Work continues to get done at a significant pace. I know there's a few questions. First up, we have Councillor Bowman.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor. I applaud you on asking for the statistics. I've heard a lot of pros and cons. We need them. We don't need them. Why don't we need them? I agree with you. The statistics are indicative of other issues that we may have in the city. For instance, you mentioned 15 or 16 people living in a single rental unit. We know where those areas are, and when we know where the hot spots are, we'll be able to compare those that data and see if it has a significant impact. I don't like the fact that Brampton is sitting right now sort of at the bottom of the pecking order. There was a Léger poll put out today, I guess, and 50% of Canadian respondents feel governments are withholding COVID-19 info. And their quote is, if Canadians trust that they get their government is being open and truthful, they'll be more likely to continue to follow the public health advice to curb the speed of the virus. Yesterday, Mayor Nenshi in Chicago, or in Calgary, I should say, said he doesn't want to be like Toronto. And then, of course, we got Doug Ford saying Brampton's a hot spot. So I think it's important that we get this information out to all our residents. And when you look at our statistics, we've passed Mississauga now, and we also have the highest number of cases in the lowest age demographic. And I'm pretty sure it's in Canada, between 20 and 29 years old. And that's startling to me. So, Canada, 12.9%, the 20 to 29 group is the fifth lowest all age group, and we're the first. So, we need to have this data. We need to make sure everybody understands and knows the data. And I don't see why the data should be kept secret. I mean, it's easy to get things like crime stats in Region Appeal. Just go on the Region Appeal police site, and you can see all the crime stats there. So, infection sites, I don't see any difference in that being done as well. And I'm hoping that we get some mobile testing soon. I had it on Facebook the other day that, is there a possibility to convert one of our unused buses into a mobile testing center? If people won't come and get the tests, maybe we need to bring the tests to them in order to get these things done. So, congratulations. Thank you for asking for these stats. And I'm hoping that we can start getting these, by tomorrow. I don't see why there isn't any reason why we couldn't. So thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor Bowman. And that is why I asked Public Health to share the data with the public. We owe it to the public to have transparency. And the province is bringing in mobile testing to the workplaces, and so there is going to be mobile testing. Matt Anderson with the province is heading this up. It wouldn't be in a bus. It's not going to be in an enclosed area like that, but they have their own mobile apparatus that is being set up. Thank you for the comments, Councillor Bowman. Councillor Williams.
Hi, yes, thank you. I just want to echo what Councillor Bowman's has talked about. I've had many calls of concerns with the Brampton being considered the hot spot, and our residents want to know where that is, and thank you for taking the lead and making sure that we get that information. And I'm also hoping that we get it quite soon so people can kind of inform their movements, their actions. And also, we know there are certain areas in Brampton that have high diabetes rates, and that really means that there are risk areas are quite high, and we want to make sure that people are able to keep themselves safe and alive. So thank you so much for doing that. I have a question. You know, right now many are at home, the weather's getting better, and people are spending time in their backyards. I've had a number of people call in with complaints to bylaw around noise, and wondering what they can do. They've approached the neighbor either might laugh or say, you know, call bylaw, or, you know, some residents are just trying to figure out what tools can they use to try and send the message that we need to be respectful in our living environments of everyone. And I'm just wondering if bylaw can kind of give us an update on whether or not those complaints are still being received, and, you know, especially as they're shifting from their regular bylaw concerns to more COVID-specific complaints. Are residents still able to feel confident that their concerns with noise and nuisance are still going to be dealt with? And is there any updates that we can receive from bylaw with regards to some of these complaints and issues that are happening within every resident's living environment and space?
Through you, Mr. Mayor and Council Williams, I just wanted to make you aware of the, Paul Morrison and I are on this call as we speak, just to make you aware that the noise bylaw is still in effect. We still continue to receive noise complaints, and we are accepting those calls, even though our work has been focused on COVID-19 related complaints. We encourage, obviously, our residents to contact us when there is a noise complaint. Having said that, we know that most of our residents, and a lot of the residents, are still at home. They have children at home, and they're playing in their backyards. So let's be reasonable about the type of complaints that we're asking the residents to report. I mean, it's important that these complaints are noise related as opposed to neighbor disputes, and let's make sure that the complaints are legitimate, and that's the biggest part. We will investigate them if they come, if they're reported, we'll attend and investigate the noise, but let's make sure they're reasonable complaints.
Great, thank you for that. So question about the noise. Some residents are still saying that they have to report it for a number of weeks before somebody will come out and issue a warning or something. Is that still happening, or has that changed?
Through the mayor, the procedures hasn't changed. We simply, once a complaint has been received, we will investigate it, establish whether there's sufficient evidence to prove to move forward. Just a simple phone call, anonymous phone calls, and these things like this, we're not going to move forward. We need to get some very basic information to be able to ensure that there was a violation. So if someone's calling in the middle of the night, we show up and at the house, and the residence is in darkness, and we don't hear any noises, we'll follow up with the homeowner and the complainant to ensure that there was in fact a noise. We get the sometimes complaints that are not substantiated, so we want to make sure that there's evidence before we start issuing notices to a violation to a homeowner. So there's a thorough investigation that's conducted to ensure that there is evidence to proceed with a notice and charges if required.
Okay, thank you. So through the mayor, then residents don't need to keep track of the noise for 2 weeks before calling into bylaw, or is 311 still going to request? They're not requesting that the resident continue to track for 2 or 3 weeks before they can make the complaint. You'll be able to receive the complaint and go out right away. So that's what I'm hearing.
Yes, that's correct. We will attend upon receiving a complaint, and we'll investigate it immediately or within a few days.
Okay, great. Thank you for that clarification. And I think that's excellent information for us to be able to go back to our residents and let them know during this time. And a lot of the calls that we get are about excessive music being played for long hours and making it difficult for people to enjoy their backyards and such. So, you know, thank you for this, and we'll definitely be taking it back and, you know, ensuring that people have the right intent and making sure that their complaints are legitimate, because I do agree that kids playing in a backyard is you know, hey, as a mom of five, the backyard is the best place for them to be blowing off some steam rather than in the house. But we do have to make sure that we are being cognizant of other people's environments as well. So thank you so much for that. And that's all those are the only questions I had. Thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Councillor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I wanted to ask about the transit. Last week, we had talked a little bit about what the, or maybe it was the week prior, the government announcing that people are to be social distancing on our buses or wearing masks. Where are we with that? I know we didn't want to go down to five riders per bus, so I think we were leaning towards trying to get everybody that comes on the bus to wear a mask. I know our ridership is increasing, I think almost daily now. So just, can I get an update on what we're doing with that?
Yes, Alex, our transit commissioner, can give you an update on that.
Absolutely, through you, Mayor. The province, Dr. Yaffe, the Associate Chief Medical Officer, last week issued some information on wearing and physical distancing on transit vehicles. And one is the reduction of fewer passengers to try to have that physical distancing of 2 meters. In our case, that would take a 40-foot bus from approximately 15 people down to 5 people. There is some clarity that through Minister Mulroney's office, the Ontario Public Transit Association is trying to get in regards to the province's announcement on that from the Ministry of Health. Once we get that and some clarity around that, there are, what I understand, the Ministry of Transportation will come up with some guidelines. But the way it stands now with just that piece of information, reducing to 5 would almost make it impractical to even run transit at that point. I know the mayor, as the mayor mentioned before, in regards to strongly recommending that masks be worn. This is something that non-medical masks be worn. That's something that comes from our Peel Region Health Department as well. And those recommendations are strongly being made, and it's a strong campaign that's coming out from public transit, for transit in Brampton as well on that. So right now we're trying to get clarity on that from the province, and then we'll reassess and then bring back to for some decisions to be made depending on what comes out of that. But you're right, the ridership is increasing as things unfold, and we are leaving people behind because of the limitations we have now at less than 1/3 capacity. I'm hoping that answers your question, Councillor Pelleschi.
No, and it does, Alex, and I appreciate that. Have we talked to the operators at all to get a sense of how many riders are coming on the bus currently with masks and the ones that are coming on the bus without?
We do have on-street supervision, and we are gauging you know approximately how many people are using. We are finding that more and more are using, and I attribute that to local health officials, our campaigns that we're doing through the mayor's office, as well as through social media, through Stratcom and Jason's group. So we are doing extensive campaigns, but I would, you know, without exact numbers, I would definitely say more than half are using them, and we see a constant increase on that. When we see our terminals, our customers at our terminals and onboard our vehicles.
Okay, that's good to know that more than half are currently wearing masks. I guess once we get a better understanding from either MTO or whomever, then we'll make that decision then. And is it clear that if we're currently, our ridership is 15 per bus, if everybody's wearing a mask, can we allow more people on the bus?
And through the mayor, these are very good questions, Councillor Pelleschi. I think the only I would suggest that the only way to start onboarding more people is to have some type of public health guidelines that allow us to do that. So, for example, if everyone wore a non-medical masks on board a vehicle and we were allowed to have a full stand, full seated load, that would certainly help our capacity issues. But, you know, as a place like TTC have been very vocal on, when you have a Bloor and, you know, on a Bloor line, Bloor and Yonge line, where you have 60 to 70,000 people going through a station, physical distancing is going to be very difficult. So clearly, if we can have some type of method through our Peel Public Health in having people wearing masks and being able to increase our capacity, that would be extremely helpful. Right now, the way the province has announced, it's going to go to reduce the amount of people we can carry. So that's something that we're trying to get clarity on, and we'll be bringing that back.
Thanks, Alex. So, Mr. Mayor, may I ask, in your discussions to Peel Public Health on the daily, that you bring this up and see if we can get their view on if we have, ultimately, if we have everybody that's on the bus wearing a mask, if we can start holding, we really don't want to be leaving anybody behind, but we also want to ensure that everybody is safe while riding the transit system. Can you ask those questions and see if we can get some clarity on it?
Yes, we can do that.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The last thing I wanted to, just a comment, wanted to let the millions of people that are tuned in listening to us right now, that this Friday, May 29th at 3 p.m., we welcome everybody to join us for a town hall on the arts, culture, and tourism community hosted by the Economic Support Task Force. And that'll be mediated by the one and the only Councillor Vincente. We want to discuss the impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic, and we'll also have an update on the city's plans for economic recovery. And I'm sure that Councillor Medeiros will be on that call as well, listening, if not saying something to the folks that will be on the call, but definitely listening to some of the concerns and things that people raise. That's it. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Next up, we have Councillor Willens.
Thank you, through you, Mr. Mayor. Just some quick updates on the garden program. 8 fire stations have built gardens at their sites at the station houses. So I'll send a list out to all the members of council on where they are. So if you're driving by, you can toot your horn. And also Scott's Canada, one of our sponsors, they want to turn our garden program into a national program through Communities in Bloom. Communities in Bloom, as you know, they're the national program for municipalities that do a lot of gardening stuff. And as well, Compost Canada wants to partner with us as well. And I had an interesting phone interview with Compost Canada yesterday. So we're getting out into the other communities now, so it's good news. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Next up, we have Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, through you, Mayor. Wanted to bring up some other concerns that were brought to us from residents with respect to contraventions in physical distancing in some of the larger, but also in smaller stores. And can staff comment on what they're doing to help businesses to manage the crowds that they're seeing or the number of the people that they're seeing visit their retail establishments?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's Paul Morrison. I can tell you that we do attend all those complaints. We meet with the management staff. We tell them about the social distancing rules and regulations as set down by the province and by the city as well. And we suggest ideas such as limiting the number of people in, direction of traffic flow, putting proper arrows on the ground or a higher level up, maybe 3 feet. We talk about that. We talk about staging on the outside of the building, the proper line, the proper footing, feet between individuals there. And we talk about possibly in the bigger settings to get security to assist with those matters, identify a lead person to oversee all the social distancing aspect.
Okay, and in terms of when we get inquiries from residents, we advise them if they see something to alert 311. Can you comment on how quickly 311 is able to respond to calls of that nature?
I can tell you we prioritize the calls through 311. I mean, if it's a social distancing call where it's concerned with numbers and we have a greater safety issue to another call, we'll go. And sometimes that pushes that social distancing call further back in the queue. It could be hours sometimes before we get there. We try to get there as soon as possible. So the time does vary.
Okay. And with respect to, we also get a good number of messages with regards to folks not physically distancing between neighbors. There are situations where it's clear that it is members all of the same household, perhaps in the backyard. But then there are other situations where families that live adjacent to one another are enjoying time, perhaps enjoying drinks or food together. Can you provide advice on what residents who have concerns with respect to that, what they can do?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, the social gathering when it comes to the household is only those that are residing in the same household that can gather together. So a family of 10 in one residence can have a barbecue, can have a pool party in the back, only with those that are in. As soon as they start inviting additional neighbors, family members that do not reside in the same household, they are in violation of the provincial orders.
And so it would be staff's advice that if residents witness that, to just report to 311, correct?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, that's correct.
Okay, thank you so much, staff. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilor Vicente. Councilor Fortini.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to go back to the noise complaints. Like, I received some, you know, my daughters are all grown up, three daughters, but, you know, when you get a beautiful day like today and yesterday, and people are calling me about complaints in their backyards, especially when our parks are all closed and schools have been closed and you can't have your own kids in the backyard making noise. I find that quite ridiculous and waste of time of 311 and bylaws. There's a difference when we have noise at night, at 1 o'clock at night, but not in the daytime. So I've been receiving calls these residents, you know, they're residents with kids. We got to cope with it. It's a cope, you know, we're going through this pandemic through a COVID-19. And, you know, I have three kids playing in my backyard and they're yelling a bit. You know, we got to remember all parks, a lot of stuff are closed. And if I can't enjoy my own backyard with my kids, I'm not going to waste 311's time or bylaws time. So I'm glad JP's and Paul Morris's staff's looking into stuff like that, not to really take things too seriously, because we all have kids. We've all been parents. And, you know, we all have backyards. Now, if the noise that happens at 1, 2 o'clock in the night, it's a whole different story. But in the daytime, we got to be a little bit more lenient towards, you know, the residents, especially when all these parks are closed. We're telling people, don't go to the parks and play, and then I can't even have them in my own backyards. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Councillor Fortini. I don't think there's any other items. Other instant messages refer to other items. Councilor Santos, you'd like to speak to this?
Yeah, it's just, so this is in relation to COVID-19. During this state of emergency, we closed down a number of parking garages in the downtown core. And Councilor Medeiros and I, who both sit on the board of the downtown BIA, our local businesses were bringing up the fact that folks are running out of parking in the downtown core. So item number 14.3, which is the correspondence letter from the downtown BIA, is asking us to find a way forward to potentially reopen some of those parking spots in the downtown core. I believe that Councillor Vicente, Councillor Medeiros have been working on a motion to bring forward, and I it would be great if we just got it done during this section.
Thank you, Councillor Santos. Councillor Fortini, you'd like to speak again?
Please, you know, are we talking about like the park in the City Hall, the Rose Theater, and the other one across the street on George Street?
I believe the motion that Councillor Vicente has in speaking with him earlier this morning has to do with only one or two specific areas. I do share some concerns about, you know, staffing and who will be staffing these garages, the garbage that will probably happen from it, And ultimately, whether or not we do legitimately need that many more parking spots in the downtown, but it would be great if Councillor Vicente could just bring it forward during this time.
Okay, so my question is, so we close up all that area, we took down these buildings, we're not intentionally building buildings, with all that lumber spent around there, with all that lumber and advertised, why don't we just asphalt that area and use it for parking downtown until we decide when to start these buildings after we tear down all these buildings? It's going to be a spot now all closed where people are just throwing garbage over the lumber or the plywood there. Maybe we could look into taking that down and re-asphalting that and use it as a parking for downtown if they need more parking. Just a suggestion. Thank you.
Okay. Are we moving the motion as part of this?
I have the motion here.
Okay, Councillor Vicente, if you want to put the motion on the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and the clerk can put it up. So staff, in response to the conversation that we had at last week, put their heads together and have prepared this resolution for us to consider. I'm happy to move the motion and would appreciate if the downtown councillors would be willing to second it for council's consideration. I'll just read it out. I believe, clerk, that you would require that.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's probably appropriate given it's just being introduced now.
Okay,
so the motion reads as follows. Whereas the World Health Organization has declared a worldwide pandemic regarding the novel coronavirus 19, and whereas on March 17th, 2020, the province of Ontario declared an emergency pursuant to Section 7.0.1 of the Emergency Management and Civil Protection Act. And whereas on March 24th, 2020, the Corporation of the City of Brampton declared an emergency pursuant to Section 4 of the Emergency Management Act. And whereas the city has established the Brampton COVID-19 Emergency Measures Bylaw to prohibit certain activities and regulate physical distancing during COVID-19 emergency, consistent with and in support of the province's emergency regulation also established under the emergency management and with the advice and recommendations of public health officials. And whereas the province has begun a phased reopening of businesses in accordance with the provincial emergency regulations, including curbside pickup and delivery. And whereas to facilitate the opening of businesses as permitted by the province's emergency regulation, there is a need to reopen certain parking facilities within the downtown Brampton business area. Now, therefore, the Council of the Corporation City of Brampton hereby resolve as follows, that the amendments to the Brampton COVID-19 Emergency Measures Bylaw, MO1-2020, attached as Appendix A to this resolution is hereby enacted, and that the city shall cease the collection of parking fees and charges for use of the Nelson Square parking garage located at 2 Diplock Lane and the George Street North surface parking located at the corner of George Street North and Diplock Lane until the emergency declaration in relation to COVID-19 made by the city is terminated.
Thank you, Councillor Vicente. The motion is on the screen. Does anyone want to speak to it?
Yeah, I'm on the board, Mayor.
Okay, Councillor Medeiros.
Thank you, Mayor. Just for some of my colleagues, thank you, Councillor Vicente, for moving it. Councillor Santos and myself do sit on the BIA, and there's been ongoing conversation, and essentially in conversations with the mayor and our CAO, we put it to the BIA to provide us with correspondence on exactly what businesses would want in terms of supporting them, understanding the public health concerns. So what this is really a reflection of that, and maybe I'm not sure if the mayor or our staff can speak to this within, I guess, the context of today, understanding that, you know, we're going to open this. Is this easy to close the garages if we see that there's an increase in numbers? Maybe I'm not sure who would be more appropriate to respond to that.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, this is Jasmir.
Yeah. Hi, Jasmir.
So we have, when we open the Nelson garage, based on the direction of your motion and as well as the surface parking lot, we will have approximately 260 spots, which we think is more than enough. But because we also used to do a daily patrol of the area when the both garages were closed, and the staff always found that the spaces were still available on the street. So I think with Nelson Garage opening as well as the surface lot opening, we will have approximately 260 spots, which is more than enough. And we have already set up the plan to do the regular daily cleaning of the area as well as monitoring it. So we are good with these two spots. But if based on the trend, we have more need, then we'll explore the options of offering the West Tower as well as the City Hall parking.
And through the mayor, thank you very much, Jasbir, for your comments, and specifically around cleanliness, because this has been an ongoing complaint from the downtown businesses and I guess from residents and client and potential customers, was how unwelcoming some of our garages were in terms of the uptake and cleanliness. So it's it'd be great if we can get it in shape and get it nice and spick and span for you know, folks who do decide to come downtown and support our downtown businesses. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Councilor Medeiros. Councilor Pelleschi.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm happy to support the motion before us, and I'm glad to see that we're going to be continuing to monitor. You know, what I don't want is for, you know, the province stating that they're easing some restrictions, they're opening up more opportunities. Those opportunities bring issues, as we know, and I know that the city of Brampton is being consistent with their messaging around you know, taking this a little bit slower. But I'm glad to see that this is only just enough. It's just a little bit. We're going to continue monitoring to ensure that, you know, people aren't using this to start some gatherings. And I think that this is a good response by the downtown councilors to support the businesses that are in desperate need of the support. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Councillor, I guess Bowman is next. No, there's just comments from Councillor Santos and Bowman.
Yeah, sorry, Mr. Mayor. All I was suggesting was that to save the city a little bit of work and extra work, can we not just open the first two levels of the Nelson Street garage in conjunction with the George Street parking? I'm sure that would be plenty of parking.
Through you, the mayor, the councillor, I just want to say that we, in the Nelson garage, we want to also block certain parking lots so that the parking space next to the other one, people respect the social distance. So we want to ensure that outside the open surface, we just want to maintain the way any other parking lot is done in the open surface. But inside the Nelson garage, we'll be blocking alternate spaces so that the people who bring their vehicles, they maintain the social distance, and then also there will be regular rounds by the staff to check that.
Okay, seeing no other questions, we have the motion on the floor.
So, Mr. Mayor, perhaps this could be a three-part motion. The first would be receiving your update on COVID-19, the second would be the motion on the screen, and the third would be receiving correspondence introduced by Councillor Santos, 14.3.
Okay, so the first item is receiving my COVID report. That's moved by Councillor Pelleschi, seconded by Councillor Willens. Are there any objections? Hearing none, my report is passed. The next item is this motion, which was moved by Councillor Vasante and the other downtown councillors. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion passes. And item three is receiving the correspondence, and that's moved by Councillor Santos and Vasante. Are there any objections? Motion carries. Okay. That takes us to 10.1, a staff report regarding the 75th anniversary of the end of the Second World War. Do any members have questions or comments regarding the staff report? Councillor Vasante.
Thank you, Mayor Brown. Through you to staff, with respect to this report on us honoring the 75th anniversary of the end of the Second World War, we also have a correspondence from Commander Verschuren, which raises a number of questions, perhaps some very minor changes to the wording in the report. Just like to ask through you to staff if we can accommodate those requests.
Thank you, Councillor, and through the chair, it's Jason. The with respect to the edits and some of the comments from the commander, we can definitely take them into consideration. The one thing I would note and be mindful of, and that I would recommend we stay aligned with, that's in the report, is the recommendations against a large gathering. I spoke this morning and consulted with the medical officer of health, and he is in agreement that September, even if it were the case that the community could do a bigger gathering, that it would certainly not be the type of gathering where we could have seniors of that that aging population in close proximity to a larger gathering, and also suggest that it's unlikely that we would be having gatherings of any great size at that point. So I would suggest we don't plan for an event, a sizable event, in light of public health's advice on that matter. And I was just speaking with him today about that. It's not in the report, but I would just note that for council's consideration of not necessarily making that a more expanded event beyond the group of five or the smaller wreath-laying memorial ceremony.
Okay, thank you, and through you, Chair. So then, notwithstanding that one caveat, we can accommodate the other minor changes?
Yes, I think we can accommodate many of the changes. My only other comment would be that the one thing that's a little unclear is whether this is an event led by the Legion or a city event. If it's intended to be a city event, and I can consult with the commander on this, if it's a city event, I'd feel an obligation to consult with all the stakeholders, including both legions, and have them both participate. And so I note the one comment about it was the delegation's presentation and the desire that they would lead it, then maybe it's an event led by the Legion versus being led by the city, but I'd feel an obligation to include all the stakeholders in the process.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Mayor.
Okay, so we have the motion on the floor, moved by Councillor Vicente, seconded by Councillor Williams. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. So we also need to adopt 14.2. Just to receive it. And that's moved again by Councillor Vasante and Williams. Any objections? Hearing none. This takes us to 10.2, heritage permit application, alterations of designed heritage property for 1169 Ocean Coosie Road. Do any members have any questions or comments regarding the staff report? Seeing none, we have a motion moved by Councillor Willen, seconded by Councillor Pelleschi to approve the staff report. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. That takes us to 10.3, change of use zoning. This matter was raised by Councillor Fertini at our last council meeting, and a report was requested for this meeting. Do any members have questions or comments regarding the briefing note? If so, please use your instant messaging section of Skype to add your name. Seeing none, we have a motion Moved by Councillor Fratini to receive the briefing note and to adopt the motion that's on the screen, seconded by Councillor Medeiros. A record of vote's been requested.
All in favor of the motion as shown on the screen, please indicate when I call your name. Councillor Santos.
Yes.
Councillor Vasante.
Yes.
Councillor Willens.
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Yes.
Councillor Bowman.
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros.
Yes.
Councillor Williams.
Yes.
Councillor Fortini.
Yes, please.
Councillor Singh.
Yes.
Councillor Dillon.
Yes.
Mayor Brown.
Yes.
That carries unanimously 11 to 0.
Okay, this takes us to our next item, 10.4, administrative bylaw for Brampton Stormwater Charge. Do any members have questions regarding the staff report? I see Councillor Dillon's got a question.
Thanks a lot. Just some residents have contacted me in regards to this, and there's just some issues that they had brought up. Because we've had a 0% tax increase this year on the city side, but this charge is going to be on the regional water bill. And so whether it's, I think it's about $89 per home, and then it's within the thousands for some of the bigger commercial properties. The question to staff is, have we not looked into how we can pay for this in some other means, just because we've had the 0% tax increases? There are not any other savings we can have within the city spending and the city budget.
I think this is the way the other cities do it, but we can check with the CAO. We can answer that question.
Great, thank you, Mayor.
Through the mayor, this is Jesper. So I'll answer this. We have submitted two reports on this. So if you see that the stormwater management, all this fees are related to the stormwater infrastructure management, which we are already about like $10 million worth of backlog is there. And already many municipalities are ahead of us, like Mississauga did the stormwater fee in 2014 or 2015. So all these fees are supposed to be going towards our stormwater management and to support our infrastructure, which is already out. Like there is a life cycle renewal already, which are long pending and delayed. And you are right that this bill will go with the region of Peel, and region of Peel has deferred the payment, and the first bill was supposed to go in the August. And if the region decides to defer it again, so we will, since we piggyback their billing system, so it will be deferred again. If you see our last report, we were recommending not to defer the, in case the region goes for deferring, so we will defer, but we are not saying that to explore other options of funding this.
So maybe, we're not exploring other options for funding?
Maybe David Barrett. Or we have you not?
Thank you, Mayor. Through you to the council as well. So as the mayor alluded to, several other municipalities have been doing this for many years. Councils considered this and discussed this even through the budget process. In fact, the budget process was approved, included these revenues for the 12-month period. The previous meeting, we advised, given the circumstances, that the option to actually, rather than begin the fee in January, rather start it halfway through the year. So currently there has been a bit of a reduction in terms of delaying the start of this fee from January till June, notwithstanding other municipalities have been doing it for several years. And again, it is lined up with the regional billing cycle. So to the commissioner's point, if they defer again, well then our bill continues to get deferred, but we do need the bylaw to be put in place so that we can at least get it initiated and set up appropriately.
So can you advise, and I understand that other municipalities are doing it, but can you advise how we got to this position where we need this fee placed on our residents? Why was it some, you know, was it mismanagement from, you know, previous councils, or how did we get to this point? Just for the information of the residents.
Well, thanks for that. I believe that Treasurer Dave Sutton is on the line as well. Perhaps can provide a little bit of the backstory to the councillor's question.
Through the chair, I'm going to, obviously I think we have some folks from Public Works on the line as well that could add to this. But we've had challenges obviously with all of our infrastructure. One of the things that was key about the levying of a stormwater charge was who would actually pay for the actual infrastructure maintenance and repairs of the stormwater. The implementation of the stormwater charge actually changes effectively who is actually paying for the infrastructure going forward, where currently it's on the property tax bill, which is largely funded through residential properties. Moving this over to a stormwater charge, and the way we've implemented it the way it's been crafted, is that it actually puts more emphasis on those types of properties that actually have put more challenges on or stress on our stormwater infrastructure. So if you can imagine those areas that have large parking lots where there's large runoff that comes off those types of properties. So it's a bit of a change in the way we actually collect the money to pay for the infrastructure. And that's one of the main purposes of the stormwater charge.
So, but will it be, and this is like, I'm looking at the table here, it says $89 for a single home, small commercial property would be $228 for a commercial plaza, $14,440. So you're saying it's the way we collect, but is this an additional charge, or is this this charge, these charges that people are going to get, is it just collected in a different way? Like, will people actually be seeing $89 additional fee?
Through the chair, yes. So people would see an $89 fee, those fees that you see outlined there on their water bill. We did provide some offset in our property tax budget for 2020 to reflect some of those, reflect that the revenue would come in through another source. And so there was revenues that were brought into our operating budget to relieve some pressure on the property tax side to keep to achieve the 0% for this year.
Right. So if I was to move a motion now for staff to report back on how we can fund this through different means, I'm sure you mentioned that looked into other options, but what could we see then if a report was to be requested and staff was to come back? Are there any other, what are the options we have to not tax our residents?
Through the chair, so I guess what I would say is that as we go through our budgeting preparation and as we make proposals to council during budget deliberations, you know, we're looking at all of our reserves and looking at our capital needs. What I will say is, you know, for council to keep in mind that we're currently projecting somewhere between a $45 and $55 million deficit for this year, which is going to put some additional pressure potentially on our reserves. We've also talked about whether that means we can defer some other capital to help offset that. You know, we still have strategic reserves, which I think council has some intentions for using those reserves. But the reality is we are looking at all the different sources when it comes to funding infrastructure. We're obviously cognizant of trying to keep, whether it be taxes or all types of fees, as low as possible in any budget cycle or for any calendar year. And so it would be very challenging to make up any shortfall in this without sort of scaling back capital programming at this point in time.
Right. So we've been trying to assist people as much as possible during the COVID pandemic, as And that's like a really important issue that people have brought up. And so just again, if this is, and I think Jaspir was mentioning this too, what is the cost to Brampton by having this deferred again?
So one thing that may be helpful at regional, Councillor Dillon, if the region defers the bill, it'll automatically defer our bill, and so we could ask that question at regional council. We did have a staff report on this last year, which council adopted. So this is the second staff report. As the clerk just reminded me, this is a user pay system. So that's the way it's set up. It's based on those that they would be using it based on the amount of usage.
Right. So. No, I think it was mentioned that it was a set fee and not based upon usage. One of the staff members had indicated. And so I want to put a motion forward to staff. I don't know if Peter, if you can possibly word it. Essentially, it's asking for alternative options to fund this instead of having it being paid by the taxpayer. I don't think it's fair that if the current taxpayers or businesses are struggling now are going to have to pay for something which I think should have been taken care of probably years ago. And so I want to move that forward. If it doesn't pass, then I'm going to vote against this recommendation.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, Michael Terrell out here. I'm the Council of the Reports. The examination of all the options to fund this in a different way was done, and there's a report that was prepared. We looked at various things like increasing property taxes and so on, and out of all the alternatives identified, this was the one that provided transparency and equity, and really it was in line with the direction other municipalities were moving. If we were to do this through property taxes, it would be providing a subsidy to the people who actually use the stormwater system the most. And we determined that the cost, if we were to do this through property taxes, would be much greater than if we did this through the user pay system. The report is available on our website. It was the basis of our report to council in June 2019.
You know, I understand that, but there's a table here that says annual charge, for example, on a 2,000 square foot home is $89. So, and then it says for a 600 square meter property, it's $228. So, but is the charge, the annual charge, based upon how large your property is? Or is it based upon usage of water?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, the annual charge is based not on the size of the property, but on the amount of hard surface on your property. It could be a very large property with just a small amount of hard surface, and you would only be charged for the hard surface that's on the property, because that is what actually affects the amount of stormwater that comes off the property.
Can you define hard surface? So if your driveway is bigger?
If your driveway is bigger, if you've expanded your home so that your roof area is bigger, that is the type of hard surface we're talking about.
Right. So it's not basically, so it'll be set every year until that charge changes, unless you expand your home or you get a bigger driveway or something. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Right. So yeah, and so I think my motion, I'm gonna to keep it on the floor.
Okay,
it's not based upon usage. Yeah, just want to look at all alternatives for funding this. I don't think it's fair for taxpayers.
So you're suggesting putting the user pay system on the taxpayer?
No, I'm suggesting that we look to alternatives. We've had a 0% tax increase for the city. I think there's other ways we can find savings to cover this, rather than have a fee or raising taxes.
I think the treasurer said that you could put it on the tax base or you could use reserves, but I don't think either of those options are ones that you're suggesting. Are they, Councillor Dillon?
Well, I just want to, I think it's for the benefit of the taxpayer to see what other options there are. When we, for example, when we have our budget deliberations, you know, we ask staff to come back and find out where we can find from savings or we can cut costs. And I think this is a, whether we have this in budget deliberations or whether we have a report come back, I think we need to, you know, this is a big amount to put on the taxpayer. And I think, you know, it'll be hypocritical of ourselves to you know, even when election time comes, say, hey, listen, we gave you 0%, but, you know, we kind of sneak it into the regional water bill. And so, which is why I'm asking for this, that we find some savings for this rather than put it on the taxpayer.
So those with large surfaces, parking lots, generally tend to be the largest users of the system would be those that are corporate. So it would essentially be a corporate subsidy we'd be proposing. But I'm going to ask the clerk procedurally how this motion could go forward, so the clerk can speak to that.
So through you, Mr. Mayor, if I understand what Councillor Dillon is proposing, you're proposing a referral back to staff for further review of alternatives. That's what I heard you say, but I just need clarity.
Alternative,
then we're
alternative.
In a referral debate. If that's the case.
Yeah, sorry, alternative options to fund this rather than it be through fees or taxes, that staff finds savings somewhere else within the city.
Through the mayor, David here, I just want to delineate a couple of things, if I may, and certainly staff are always happy to bring forward any and all information. In fact, I believe much of what's being requested has already been produced and so can be reproduced. But there's the 0% reference was on the operating side, and so what we're talking about really is in the capital project side. And these capital projects have been approved by council, so we're bordering on reopening the budget with respect to which projects still want to go forward with, which projects are determined to be funded in which ways, either debenture, reserve, various capital levies. There's two different levies currently, the transit levy, infrastructure levy, 2%, the stormwater fee. So there's a lot of moving parts, certainly. I'm happy to provide the information, but just to have the awareness of it's not an additional tax that goes into the operating. It is to fund specific stormwater projects, capital projects. And if the stormwater fee doesn't cover it off, these projects have been done historically over the decades on the property tax base. So that's, you know, we're back to square one, so to speak. And I don't know if that helps to clarify the issue at all. And happy to bring that information back as well.
No, I understand the argument you're making that it could, if we don't, it'll subsidize some of these businesses. But what I'm saying is I don't want it to negatively affect some of these businesses as well, because I think staff had made it clear that this is not just a different method of collecting a fee or tax or to pay for it. This is an additional tax that's going to be put upon our businesses. It's going to be put upon our residents as well. And so, you know, I understand that, you know, other cities have done it, but I don't think other cities are in the same situation as us as well. And so I think we need to find alternatives rather than putting this on our business or our residential tax base.
Okay. Councillor Dillon has made his point. I would just say we can vote on whether we want to receive information. The CEO has said we've received this once, but we could receive it again. I would caution against it. We do have a capital budget which we have to support, and I think this would be viewed by the public as subsidizing plazas and places that have a larger use of the stormwater management system. And so I do believe the system that other municipalities have and that Brampton has in the region of Peel adopts is the fair and equitable one, but council is always entitled to seek more information. We've had two reports on this, and we've all voted for this once, where these options were outlined, but I think we have a few speakers. Hopefully this doesn't turn into a lengthy debate that we're now having a third time, but Councillor, is it Vicente or Pelleschi first?
Councillor Pelleschi.
Okay. Councillor Vicente has requested the recorder vote, but Councillor Pelleschi is up next.
Okay. I think the recorded vote was on the last one. Okay. But, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And, you know, I understand where Councillor Dillon is coming from. It is a tough situation that we're putting people in when we're talking about this again. I agree with the CAO's determination on the reopening, and I find that this is a reopening. From my recollection of the discussion around the stormwater charge, I believe that we've discussed this four times, twice, once in budget, once in council, a workshop, and then I know that staff reached out to every member of council to set up meetings to discuss how we're going to do this. I think the City of Brampton held off as long as they could. I think we are the last municipality to implement the stormwater charge. And additionally, I think all members of council know how much I dislike stormwater ponds, and have repeatedly requested that we come up with some other solution to handle the stormwater surge of water in the municipality. I don't think that at this time is we should be going back on what this council has determined is the best course of action. I think staff, when they came to us, tried to do their ultimate best to manage this, and I think essentially we all know what the cause of this is, and that's the fact that development growth doesn't pay for growth with our growing municipalities. So I'm not going to support us re-looking at this. I think we've done that through the four series of discussions that we've already had on this. I'll support this going forward, what's currently on the board. I know it's a tough situation given the world that we live in today. But that being said, Mr. Mayor, in support of what's currently before us. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Pelleschi. Councillor Fratini.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Yeah, this is a hard decision, and I know what Gurpreet's trying to get, and Councillor Dillon. You know, what really bothers me is that, you know, going back about 4 years ago, the Region Appeal gave the grant to everyone to move their downspouts and make sure it goes on the grass. So a lot of people receive money, the $400-something to put the downspouts out, and also receive some money up to $1,000 for a backwash valve so they don't get flooded. But meanwhile, all this water is going, instead of putting it on the grass, the downspouts are going into the driveways. And this is where we have a problem with the widening of the driveways. That's why I wanted a permit from the day one. But what I'm concerned is when we look at backyards, our bylaw says we only need 2 feet away from the fence. You could have a whole backyard of interlocking or asphalt or concrete. That water also goes into the swales, and it goes into the drains. So we have to, you know, it's very unfair when you have a single driveway, the same type of home, one has a single driveway, and then you go across the street, he's got a double driveway, and his whole backyard is full of concrete, and they're paying the same amount, and the roof size is the same, because you get a lot of water from the square footage of your roofs coming down, and they're paying the same. But at the end, it's going to be very hard to go from home to establish all that. And we need this money because the parking lots are bringing in tons of money for the waste management. And we need this also for the environment. It has to come to a point where we have to say we cannot subsidize this. So I cannot support. I understand what Gurpreet's saying, that we would do a zero tax increase. But at the end of the day, we have to do what's right. And all municipalities are doing the same thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Fratini. Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, Mayor. I think most of it's been said by staff quite succinctly, but just to state that we've been briefed on this a number of different times, and staff came to us with this solution, really, which is essentially a more progressive, a fairer way of raising the necessary funds to pay for a very important piece of our urban infrastructure, which is stormwater management facilities. This system is only going to get more expensive, folks, and as it increases in size and complexity and begins to age, the cost to the municipality to repair and replace this infrastructure is going to only head north. And so by applying this fee, we do something which is actually quite smart. We shift the responsibility for reducing the amount of water penetration, of increasing the amount of water penetration into the ground by encouraging people who have more permeable area. Of course, if your house is smaller and has less roof size, then you're going to be paying less. The more significant bulk of the charge goes to commercial enterprises that have considerably large parking areas. And even they, if they choose to, have ways and means to reduce the amount of non-permeable surface that they have on their lands. And so this really shifts the cost of maintaining this infrastructure. Here in the city of Brampton, we have most of the cost is being borne by residential ratepayers because 80% of our tax base is residential. And this stormwater charge more fairly applies the necessary fees so that we can maintain very important infrastructure. To do it any other way, to say that we are going to find other ways means a reduction in services, or if we are going to apply it through the tax levy, it means that we will be putting the greater burden of this cost onto our residential ratepayers. So I think this has been explained to us many times, and we have supported this before, and so I will be supporting the report as it is. Thank you.
Councillor Williams.
Hi, yes, thank you. Through the mayor, just a quick question. Can you just, to the staff, can you just review or just remind us how you will be determining how much residents will be paying? Is it a satellite image or that you're taking, or you're comparing it to like a medium, small, large? Can you just review that process on how you're going to determine who pays what? Thank you.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, on the residential side of it, we do examine the ortho imagery that the city captures every year, and we measure the roof area of the property. We've done an analysis of a number of properties spanning various sizes, and we've come up with a rough relationship between the roof area and the amount of other hard surfaces on that property, like patios and so on. So we, from the ortho imagery, we can measure the roof area. We will apply that factor to come up with a total impervious area. And then there's a number of categories that they fit in. There are five categories based on the size of the roof area. The middle category represents the bulk of the residential properties in Brampton. Roughly 44% of them fit into that category, and that is taken as the reference, the baseline. And properties in that category will pay a standard fee of $89. That is the base fee. It is equivalent to one billing unit. Looking at the other categories, two of them are smaller, two of them are larger. The charge in each one of those categories is related to the base charge by how much you differ, being larger or smaller than that middle category.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Councillor Bowman.
Hi, through you, Mr. Mayor. I'll call a question, please.
Okay, there's no other speakers as it is. A recorded vote on Councillor Dillon's motion.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. So a recorded vote has been requested on the motion, and sorry, this is Councillor Dillon's referral motion.
Yes.
And the motion would be that this matter be referred back to staff to review alternative funding models for offsetting stormwater charges. All in favor of the referral motion, Councillor Santos?
Nope.
Councillor Visante?
No.
Councillor Willens?
No.
Councillor Pelleschi?
No.
Councillor Bowman?
No.
Councillor Medeiros?
No.
Councillor Williams?
No.
Councillor Fortini?
No, please.
Councillor Singh? Councillor Singh?
No.
Thank you. Councillor Dillon?
Yes. Can we get a recorded vote on the actual recommendation as well?
We can. And Mayor Brown, your vote?
No.
So, Mr. Mayor, that referral motion does not carry. It is 1-10. The next recorded vote would be on the staff recommendations, moved by Councillor Fortini, seconded by Councillor Visante. All in favor of the staff recommendations? Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Councillor Visante?
Yes.
Councillor Willens?
Yes.
Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman?
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
No.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
That motion and the report carries 10-1.
Okay, thank you for dealing with item 10.4. It takes us to, we've already dealt with 10.5, 10.6, 10.7 in consent. It takes us to 10.8, action plan to address the improper disposal of sharps. The matter was raised by Councillor Santos at our last council meeting, and a report was requested for this meeting. Are there any questions about this report? If so, please put your name in the instant messaging box. Councillor Williams.
Hi, yes, through the mayor. Thank you so much for the report. It's really great to see that we're taking some active measures to ensure that we are having safe disposal of sharps and encouraging people to be safe with their usage. I know I had some questions during the last meeting when this motion was brought forward. And so I'm just wondering about the areas that were identified in the report. They're all in the downtown area, and I'm just wondering if there were any other areas that may have been flagged as potential areas for concerns or areas that sharps have been found that may benefit from some type of disposal unit as well.
Through you, Mayor Brown, thank you, Councillor Williams, for your question. I have Jason Keddy, who should be on the line, who can answer to the specific locations. From my understanding, it was based on statistics from or security services. When they identify a sharp that was improperly disposed of, they record that information in their database, and based on their findings and the frequency of that occurrence, it is what was used to determine the locations. But Jason Keddy, if you're on the line, if you could speak a little bit more to that.
Certainly, thank you, Mikkel. To you, Mr. Mayor. Councillor, we've also included sharps disposals for Knightsbridge and the Regeneration Thrift Store, which is outside of the downtown, for this pilot.
Okay, great. Because I do know that the Civic Center does have some in the washrooms, but outside of that, I was just wondering if there were other areas. So that's good to know that there will be other areas looked into. So the bins design and color, when you're going through the procurement process, the region will be doing the procurement, is that correct?
Through you, Mayor, through you, Mayor Brown, just addressing your question, Councillor Williams, with regards to the receptacles themselves, the procurement, yes, is done through the region, and I believe at the last city or the last two city council meetings, you had brought up the yellow bin and how mm-hmm. the look and feel of what that would be. I'm happy to report that the receptacles themselves now are of a light gray color, so they don't stand out as much as they used to. But I also have some staff here from the region who can speak a little bit more to the design of it, if that's what your question is, or if you need some more explanation.
Yeah, it would be great to know if the design, it's good to hear that they are of a more neutral color that is a bit more, you know, hidden, because I do think of people who use these receptacles for insulin injections, for example. It's just a deterrent, that big bright color. And so I was just wondering around the possibility of bins that can be look similar to what we have, the nice blue bins with the spokes around them, or, you know, other models that have been piloted in other cities. So if that is an option or a possibility, if that is going to be explored when the region is doing their search.
I can answer that question. This is Erwin Pascual from Region Appeal. So through you, Mr. Mayor. Yes, the bins that we're procuring are light gray in color. They're made out of metal, so they're not they don't stand out as much. They're fairly understated. We do have some leeway as to a little bit of the messaging that can be put on the bin itself. Mm-hmm. The bin will indicate what materials can go in the bin and what doesn't. It will also indicate some contact information should there be any problems with the bin. Okay. But as far as a more detailed design, we can't proceed too far in that direction at this point. This being a pilot, these bins are being rented or leased, mm-hmm. So we don't own them. So we're kind of limited in the amount of modifications we can do to their appearance. But once we get through the pilot, and if these bins prove to be effective, then we can look into ownership and then other possibilities of design.
Okay, great. So I know that this is a year-long pilot, and updates are so important for us. And I think being at the City Council, we don't always get as much information with what's happening at the region. And it's so great to have the conversation here as well, because it's something that residents have asked about. I would like to amend the recommendations to say that the city receive updates during the 1 year pilot with the opportunity for us to discuss whether bins need to be relocated, especially the bins that are underutilized as we go forward. So I wonder if we can just add that to the recommendations that the city receive updates. So that's one piece. But also, before I go, I just wanted to ask about the mid to long-term recommendations. And I see in the report it mentions about consumption sites. Now, I know Brampton there was a plan, I believe it was FAN, that is now called Moyo, had put in a bid to have a consumption treatment site in Brampton, but that didn't happen. And then the province, with the changeover, they created a new model, which is the consumption and treatment service model. Now, with that model, I believe all of the sites were supposed to roll out and be established by April 2020, and I guess with COVID, we've seen there's delays. With Toronto having four, Brampton, we don't have any. Mississauga, you can correct me if I'm wrong. I don't know if I think they might have one. What are the plans for Brampton having a safe consumption treatment center here? Do we have somebody who's already put in a proposal or a bid? What is the plans for that?
Hello, it's Inga Pedra here from Peel Public Health. I can speak to that to some extent.
Thank you, Inga.
Thanks. So through you, Mayor, Councillor, definitely. So I think there are steps being taken at the Region of Peel. As you might recall, a Region of Peel, along with in partnership with Moyo Community Health Services, did complete a feasibility study with respect to consumption services in Peel. And that study did indicate that there is a need for supervised consumption services in Peel. The study findings are available online. As well, the Peel Board of Health in December endorse the study findings. And so the next steps are to work with community stakeholders and create an implementation and planning table that will then ensure we're taking the appropriate steps to prepare for an application, to complete the necessary community consultations and the steps required to move forward with sites and identify where are the most appropriate locations if we do put forward an application.
Okay, so the planning, thank you, through the mayor. So the planning table that you're speaking of will be put forward with one of the stakeholders organizations or from the region? Who is spearheading that? If you can just clarify, please.
Thank you, through the mayor. So it will be Peel Public Health partnering with Moyo Community Health Service.
With Moyo, okay.
But there will be various community stakeholders who are currently involved in harm reduction and are interested in these services being available, being part of that table.
Okay, great. So that's great to know, and I look forward to updates as they come out. So this is a really great thing to hear. And there is the van that's been using. So with the vans that you have, were there any discussions in the interim during COVID around increasing the hours or, really increasing the hours so that it can run on a Sunday or something? Was that discussion had to help alleviate some of the sharps that are found on the ground right now?
Hello, this is Natalie LaPaz from Peel Public Health, and I could speak to this.
Thank you, Natalie.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. In response to COVID, we have maintained our services of the mobile outreach vans, and we've in fact expanded our services. We are one of the few services that are available to support this population within the COVID experience. We continue to have services of our mobile vans available from 4:30 to 10:30 every day, and we also are doing work with community partners and looking at other specific locations that our van can visit during the day to provide harm reduction supports that was brought online in response to COVID.
Oh, this is great to hear. So this is question is a little bit unrelated. During our youth task force meetings, we did this conversation around the safe injection van going around, and some people questioned where youth can get condoms. They used to be able to pick them up at some of these locations and then, or even at schools, and now that they're not available, youth are wondering where they can get their condoms. Does the van also offer that as well, and is that something we can help spread the word about?
Through the mayor, yes indeed, that is something that we do offer on the van. We do offer a range of safer sex supplies, and those would be available to anyone that contacted our service. Our information is on the website in terms of the number to call our van, and we would meet our clients that we serve in Peel at a location of their choosing.
Okay, I'm just reminded by the clerk that we have to keep this on topic.
So. On topic of sharps, sorry. Once I have you, I need to get you. Thank you so much for answering that question. I think it's going to be very helpful, especially as we meet back with the organizations through the Youth Task Force, because the question around sharps did come up. And as there are, young people who are engaging in substance use and are looking for this support service. So thank you so much. This is very helpful. And just for the recommendation number four, if we could replace the word regular updates with maybe quarterly, so then that way there's a bit more structure around when those updates come through, it'd be really great. Thank you so much. I'm looking forward to seeing this roll out. I think it's going to be very helpful for the community. And, I think it's important that when you're taking care of a community, you have to take care of everyone. And you are only as strong as your weakest link. So those who are experiencing the difficulties with substance, we definitely need to make sure that they are safe and they are taken care of. And using harm reduction is a good way for us to be doing that. So thank you so much, everyone at the region. And I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Next up, we have Councillor Santos.
Thanks so much. So when we brought this up 2 weeks ago, we had asked for this report back. And in the meantime, we also brought it up at the region. The region who are there, hi, everyone at the region, in collaboration with the city. It's amazing to see the city and region working together, particularly on this issue, and super happy about the pilot project over a period of 12 months. And look forward to further collaborating with the region, especially on this particular file. So just a comment from me to say thanks to all the staff who hustled to make this happen.
Councillor Pelleschi.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. In looking at the report, I just wanted to ask staff, I guess in particular, maybe Jason, I can't find in here, I see that some of the sites, 13 sites have been identified. As far as the data to determine how many receptacles or either wall mounted or kiosk styles should be in place, how many sharps were located and approximately the time frame of each of these sites?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, it's Jason Keddy. Since COVID started, we've, through security, have reported 44 safely disposed sharps within the downtown. And that is approximately 30 incident reports more than this time last year. We looked at locations where we're finding them, also anecdotally through conversations with transit, parks. They also play a key role in sharps pickups, as well as facility services. So the locations were determined based on the frequency of finding sharps.
But the numbers we have are the ones that have been used in safe disposals?
Sorry, can you repeat that, Councillor?
You said there was a number, 44 sharps were safely disposed of?
Unsafely.
Oh, I didn't catch the un. Okay. All right.
The unsafely disposed.
Okay. So 44 in total have, I guess, been found and now safely disposed of?
Correct.
Okay. And then just on the Councillor Williams' addition to the motion, I'm happy to see that. I'm happy to support the quarterly updates on this going forward in the pilot project. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Next, do we have any other speakers? No more. Okay, so we have the motion on the floor. Moved by Councillor Santos, seconded by Councillor Bowman. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Next up is item 10.9, possible freeze of user fees and other fees. The matter was raised by Councillor Medeiros at last week's committee of council meeting and a report was requested. Do any members have questions or comments regarding the staff report? Seeing none, we have the motion on the floor, moved by Councillor Medeiros, seconded by Councillor Fortini. And a recorded vote has been requested.
All in favor of the staff recommendations, please indicate. Councillor Santos?
Yes.
Councillor Vasante?
Yes.
Councillor Willens?
Yes.
I heard a yes there. Councillor Pelleschi?
Yes.
Councillor Bowman?
Yes.
Councillor Medeiros?
Yes.
Councillor Williams?
Yes.
Councillor Fortini?
Yes, please.
Councillor Singh?
Yes.
Councillor Dillon?
Yes.
Mayor Brown?
Yes.
That motion carries unanimously, 11 to 0.
Okay, that takes us should we do the corresponding item 14.1 as well?
Yes, we can do that now.
Okay. And the motion is moved
Councillor Medeiros,
by Councillor Medeiros and Fortini. Are there any objections? Hearing none, this motion passes as well. That takes us to 10.10. Our next item staff report regarding the budget amendment funding strategy for Brampton Fire and Emergency Services Williams Parkway Fire Campus. Do any members have questions? Councillor Santos.
Thank you. Through you, Mr. Mayor, and I am in support of the recommendations for this particular report. I believe that this has been in discussion. The construction of the new fire headquarters has been in discussion for 20 years or something like that. I remember in February of this year sitting in headquarters and in a meeting in the boardroom, and we were discussing the importance of diversity, equity, and inclusion with the labor folks as well as the management team. And I remember it in February being stifling hot. That headquarters is starting to fall apart. And when you add up the totals for state of good repair for each of the buildings within the report and the presentation, if we were to delay this any further, it will equate to what this budget amendment is. And so I am absolutely asking for my colleagues to support the budget amendment. I don't think we can delay it any further. It's unfortunate that perhaps, I'm not sure if staff have anything to say about what happened and why the number was off a little bit. But at the end of the day, state of good repair for the other older buildings that are crumbling apart will cost us a lot more in the longer run.
Councillor Plushy.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It was nice seeing the additional report from 2015 when some new members of council really wanted to move the headquarters and develop the campus. And I'm glad to see that, you know, this slowly, surely that this is coming along. I know that it was former Chief Michael Clark's father who first brought this, and what Councillor Santos said about 20 years ago. So I'm glad that finally this is, it's again slowly but surely, but moving along quite well, and I'm happy to support it going forward. Thank you.
Okay, with a motion on the floor, moved by Councillor Fertini, seconded by Councillor Williams. Any objections? Motion carries. This takes us to committee reports. We have one committee report from the minutes of today's agenda. Under Council's meeting procedures, the committee or section chair introduces the committee report. The committee report we have, page 24. Committee of Council met on May 20th. The committee minutes are here for Council's consideration and approval. I will now pass the chair to the respective section chairs in order of the consideration during the committee meeting to lead Council in the consideration of the committee recommendations. Councillor Vicente chaired the Economic Development and Culture section. Councillor Singh chaired the Corporate Services. Councillor Vicente chaired Public Works. Councillor Santos chaired Community Services. Council will then consider a motion to approve the recommendations in its entirety after all section chairs have concluded their summaries and any resulting questions. So first up, Councillor Vicente.
Thank you, Mayor. Members of Council, do any of you have questions with regards to any of the sections under Economic Development and Culture or Public Works and Engineering? Seeing none, back to you, Mayor.
Councillor Singh.
Hi, do any members have any questions regarding the Corporate Services section? Seeing none, I pass it back to you, Mayor Brown.
Councillor Vicente.
Do any members have questions with regards to the Public Works and Engineering section? I see none, Mayor. Back to you.
Councillor Santos.
Any members have any questions regarding the Community Services section? Seeing none, over to you, Mayor.
Thank you. I have a motion moved by Councillor Singh, seconded by Councillor Vicente to approve the committee minutes. Any objections?
Oh, no.
Hearing none, motion carries. There's no unfinished business. There's no, was there additional correspondence? Dealt with that, 14.3. 14.1 was dealt with at 10.9. 14.2 was considered as part of item 10.1. This takes us all the way to 18.1, referred matters list. The list is published quarterly on a meeting agenda, and a copy is linked with each agenda to include a current listing of matters referred to city staff for further review and report back to council or committee. Do any members have any questions for the referred matters list? Seeing none. We have new business, Councillor Bowman, 18.2.
Thank you very much through you, Mr. Mayor. I've had a very large number of calls, 14 exactly, since last Thursday from residents on many different streets in Ward 3 and 4 regarding issues mainly dealing with vehicular speeding, but also street racing, not stopping at stop signs, especially near school zones and park zones, gatherings of up to 5 or 10 cars meeting in a parking lot and then going and following one another above the speed limit all the way up the streets. And these have come from everywhere. They've come from Credit View. They've come from El Dorado to Steeles, Bonnie Braes, Drinkwater, Steeles, Chincoosie Road, Main Street, Eldemar, Meadowland, Guest Street even, and Kevin Miniker was over at Guest Street yesterday talking to the residents. There seems to be, and I don't think it's just me, but we seem to have a very large problem right now with drivers disobeying the speed limits, disobeying stop signs and the rules of the road. And we need to curb this activity or somebody is going to get hurt. I think the police, Peel Regional Police, Mr. Mayor, you were speaking about it this morning, if I'm not mistaken, about their street racing. And I've got the statistics here. Just on the weekend from Peel Regional Police, they were targeting street racing. They laid 131 Highway Traffic Act charges, 127 bylaw offenses, 614 vehicles were investigated, and 5 of those vehicles were subsequently seized. Credit View Road has been a point of topic for years. When I started on council, people then were asking for some type of speed reduction, whether it was soft shoulders or whether it was more stop signs. And every time we ask, and believe me, I have no issue with how our traffic people are doing their studies and how they're working. They're doing a great job. My problem lies in the fact that we do traffic studies. We complete the studies over 4 or 5 a week, and they all come back and they say the same thing. You know, 80% of the people that were measured are between 6 or 7 kilometers of the speed limit, up or down. To me, that indicates that 20% of the cars measured, so say we measured 20,000 cars over the course of 3 or 4 days, 4,000 of those cars are going 7 kilometers per hour or more over the speed limit. We've measured cars going over 110K down Main Street, and still we don't seem to be doing anything about it. We ask for speed mitigation measures, where the traffic cameras, they took us 6.5-7 months before the first ones are even going to be up and active. We seem to be moving fairly slowly on this. And with this COVID crisis, more people are home, more kids are playing, and more kids and adults are out driving their cars around the streets. And I don't know whether it's, whether we don't have enough police enforcement. You know, they're doing their best to do everything else. Our bylaw is doing everything they possibly can with the COVID crisis as well. But there's something we need to do. And I don't know whether it's, I'm going to put forward a motion, ask, Ashley, if we can get a report back from our traffic people. Is there anything we can do to speed up the process of getting speed mitigation measures in place on the streets that have been identified in the report we had just 3 or 4 weeks ago? So I'd like somebody to come back with a report to council on how we speed this up before somebody does get killed on one of these streets. you know, we're going to be off school now, right through until September. If we start then, we still don't know for sure. And during that time, there's going to be a lot of kids out on their front lawns, in the park, on the street, playing by themselves or, you know, with a family member. And there is just, in my estimation, we have a severe problem right now in this city with people speeding and disobeying traffic regulations. So I want a report to come back on how we speed the process up of slowing vehicles down.
So Councilor Bowman, last week we passed a motion asking for a report by June on how we can speed this up. And so it's what I referenced last week, that I was frustrated how long it takes to get these speed enforcement zones in place. And so we're going to have this report in place by this report will be to council by June.
That's good that we have that report, but I'd also like a report back on all the areas we've looked at for four-way stops or three-way stops or you know, medians or signage or whatever, because I think we need to speed that process up. Like I said, Credit View Road has been talked about for going on 6 years now since I've been a councillor. How do we slow the speeders down on the street? And we haven't done anything.
Yeah.
We haven't put them off shoulders. We haven't done anything. I want to know how we speed that process up.
So Councillor Bowman, I think part of the challenge is previously people have tried other mechanisms and nothing works as effectively as a big fat ticket. You can put a sign up and say, please slow down. They do not slow down. All the studies have shown they do not slow down. The financial penalty, that deterrence actually works. And so we can look at alternatives in terms of additional stop signs or signs asking people to politely slow down. But I have to say, the deterrence that a ticket brings is the most powerful because it hits their pocketbooks. But maybe Jasbir can speak if we can get included in the report coming back to council for June, what additional alternatives can be included.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, thanks. And in that report, definitely we want to submit in that report all the details because we want to engage the field police and other, there are many stakeholders in this. And I always mention that also the community education is a major piece in this. And you very rightly said that we can put signs, we can make it a 2 million cameras, community, gated community, put the speed breakers and all this. But at the end, it's the man behind the car, what he's doing. So we will do the benchmarking, we'll engage all the stakeholders, and definitely in that report, we will come up with all the recommendations.
Okay, and those will include ways that we can speed up. Once we do a traffic study, we can speed up the implementation of the answers that we're looking for, because to me, I agree with the mayor, a big fat ticket does have an impact, but you know what? A death of a child or a resident is going to have a much bigger impact on me than seeing someone get a big ticket. And I want to stop that before it happens. And we seem to be increasing every single day the number of calls that we get about speeders in the neighborhoods.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, Councilor Bowman, yes, we will bring in the all the avenues how to speed it up, the whole process. We will cover in that report.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, and to Jasbir, I think you heard last week from council when we discussed this that we're impatient to see this rolled out to every single school zone in the city. I'm looking forward to that report in June. We get far too many complaints about speeding and street racing, and I don't want to be in a position where we have to say we only have 5 of the 200 school zones covered. I want to see that plan of how we're going to have all 200 community safety zones with cameras up, if not this year, then next year at the latest. Councillor Williams wanted to speak to this as well.
Hi, yes, thank you, Mayor Brown. And, you know, I think, Councillor Bowman, you're right on point. It's important for us to keep looking at ways to get the message across to people that they need to slow down. You know, in my ward, we've had people killed. There has been a child that was killed because of a driver using his vehicle excessively. So, you know, I really, I've heard over and over again that people say that the signs don't work. We do know that mindfulness is important. And the more often you see the message to slow down, your brain has to process that information. And people have commented that, you know, when I see a sign, I automatically read the speedometer and I take my foot off the gas if I am speeding faster than I should be. So, you know, it also comes down to road design. We hear that conversation quite often. How are our roads designed in a way to encourage speeding? And we see Brampton being an area that is on a grid and the roads are wide. People just naturally start to speed up in these areas. So road design, reminders to check your speed, and also ticketing. Ticketing does curb behavior. So the question I have, and I heard Jasbir mention about going and looking at the police and seeing what the police have, do they have the staff to manage these complaints and issues that we have on our roads? My question would be, or would want to include going to the police board and asking the police board to come back with some information. And I know Mayor Brown, you sit on the police board. Is there a way that you can bring this up to the board to say, look, how many police officers do we have in Brampton that deal with traffic calming, that are going out and ticketing bad behavior when we see on the roads? How many officers do we have doing that? And I think once we get that baseline, we understand maybe there are only 6 or 7 officers for the whole city of Brampton that are on a shift doing traffic calming, then it explains why we're not seeing people getting ticketed as often. And is that something that we can do pretty soon? So I fully support Councillor Bowman in saying, like, let's look at how we can expedite this, how we can get this done faster. But I think we also have to remember there are different ways to manage driving behavior. And I have to say, signs do work, and people have said that they are more aware of their driving habits when they see a please slow down sign. But you're not going to get a person that is a chronic speeder or a person that doesn't care to always follow a sign. I know, we see that happening, but it does help a community feel like they're being engaged in the process and encouraging their neighbors and their friends and families and everybody who is out there on these roads to be more mindful of their speeding. Thank you.
So in terms of the police, Chief Nishan Dharapa does come to council and answer questions sporadically, and we can certainly arrange for that. I can tell you what he'll tell you is that we don't have enough police officers, that on a per capita basis, we don't have as many as we need, and he puts his officers on the most serious crimes, and so we have people assigned to gun and gang activity. Domestic violence is the number one source of calls, and so there's only so many officers that you can assign to speeding. It's why they welcomed the use of technology. It's why the police supported our push to have photo radar in school zones. Technology can make a big difference. One of the reasons we talked about those cameras on the 410 when we had some of those shootings. Technology can enable the police to have a broader reach. And so I think all these things are nice, having a slow down sign or a three-way stop or a speed bump, which becomes challenging for the snow removal equipment. All those other things are nice, but the real difference is going to be financial deterrence. It's getting that big fat ticket, but I would welcome a report that highlights everything that is in the toolkit. We have no other speakers on this. We have the motion moved by Councillor Bowman, seconded by Councillor Pelleschi. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Council Medeiros, a senior's motion.
Yes, very quickly, Mayor. Just for my colleagues, myself and I know Councillor Fortini and Councillor Williams, we sit on the Senior Council's, the Senior Citizens Council. My apologies for mucking the name, but essentially Seniors Council, and the president approached me and had discussed about having a Seniors Day, understanding and recognizing that the city does great work in recognizing Seniors Month, and we have numerous activities, but to, I guess, the Seniors Council's executive board, and an opinion which was shared with me, that is shared by many seniors groups, that especially during this pandemic, it's really highlighted, I guess, issues of depression and isolation of seniors, and they're looking for a way to commemorate within the Seniors Month a Seniors Day, which could include flag raising or anything, and through consultation with them, the sort of the best that we came up with was that we would just have staff work with Seniors Council to identify a day and sort of identify what activities could be done. So I'm not sure if it's still possible this year that they could do something virtually to recognize a Seniors Day. You know, I did again, you know, thoroughly discuss, and staff also raised issues around, not issues, raised awareness of all the great things we do at the city, and staff does a great job celebrating Seniors Month, but they seem to have a strong opinion to want to have a Seniors Day. So this is essentially, it's just asking staff to work with the Seniors Council to sort of identify what could be a Seniors Day and how they would plan on celebrating, and any costs associated, certainly I expect that would come back to council for our approval.
Okay, seeing no, Councillor Fortini?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you to Councillor Medeiros. Yes, we've been contacted by the seniors. So I know we cannot do any flag raising or anything like that. They wanted enough. Maybe, I don't know how staff could do maybe on Zoom or something for them. We suggested, and they just want one day. I know it's going to be hard for them to do the social distancing during this time. So Councillor Medeiros is absolutely right, and maybe we could see how we could work with them and try to achieve at least one day to keep the seniors going, and saying that, you know, it's Seniors Month, and we could have one great day. Thank you. And I'm happy to second the motion. Yeah.
Okay. No other speakers. Motion moved by Councillor Medeiros, seconded by Councillor Fortini. Any objections? Motion carries. Oh, Councillor Fortini, your item now on swimming pools.
Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, I almost forgot. So I know I had brought this up a couple of weeks ago on the swimming pools. We are the only municipality with no permit. So I had a call, this Sunday, that some resident wanted to bury her pool, like just cover it up, because she needed a new liner and she's a certain age, but you need a permit. So I just don't get this. So I have a swimming pool. I don't need a permit to put it in, but I need a permit to bury it. How would we know if I'm going to bury my pool when there was never a permit in place? That's why I just don't, can't figure this out. Why do we have to spend $50 and get a permit to bury my swimming pool when there was never a permit in place to build it? So I'm a little bit confused on that. And I looked through our bylaw books, and yes, you do need a permit to bury the pool.
Mayor Brown and members of council, it's Richard.
Yeah, yes.
We have our CBO on the line as well, Rick Kennard, yeah, who can probably provide a little bit of the history on in terms of pools and the necessity to get a permit to bury a pool. There are some requirements for that, but I'll let Rick Kennard speak up.
Yeah, and I kind of understand, sorry not to interrupt, I kind of understand why you need a permit, but you don't want to put dirt in there, and all of a sudden the water doesn't escape anywhere. It's just going to sit there. It's going to be like a swamp because they leave the liner and all. But why would we need a permit? My question is, we don't need one to build, but how would we know if I'm going to bury my pool and I just did it and I didn't get a permit, if there was never a permit in place to build it? That's where I'm a little bit confused.
Correct. So I believe that Rick is on the line, but I'm not surprised by the question. I would have thought it would have been the other way around in terms of the heat, that people would want pools, but perhaps Rick Kennard can speak to it.
Yeah, good. This is Rick. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yep.
Okay. So, you know, I'm a little bit interested to hear some more details about this specific scenario, Councillor, but so you're correct in saying that we don't require building permits for the installation of the pool. What we actually require a permit for is the erection of the enclosure around the swimming pool. So the pool itself is not a designated structure in the Ontario Building Code, but we do have a bylaw in place in the city of Brampton, as in most municipalities, that requires a specific type of enclosure to be built around the swimming pool. And so that is the purpose of the permitting system and the approval system when installing. And part and parcel with that is the approval of the lot grading and overall drainage of the property. And so I think this is where we get into the decommissioning of the pool, in that if you're going to be filling your property in any fashion, not just by the decommissioning of a swimming pool, that you would seek approval from the city for alterations to the lock rating. And so essentially it's to ensure that you're not adversely affecting the adjoining properties by the fill that's added to the site. So, you know, if it's a simple, you know, straightforward backfill, crack the concrete a couple of times to let some drainage out, and backfill the pool, it really shouldn't be an issue. But the administration that goes behind it is just the review of what it is you're doing when you're altering the grading of the property to make sure that your neighbors aren't affected by that work.
So, yeah, and I understand that. So when you buy a home, you know, you get insurance. The first thing they ask you, you have a fireplace, you have a pool, and that's how they base you on your insurance. So I have a swimming pool. I don't have a permit when the pool was put in 1985. So now I want to bury it. How do you know if I bury the pool? There was one in the backyard and now one, there was no permit from the pool. So really, I'm not touching the grade. I'm just going to backfill it inside the level with the pool. That water does not escape. It sits there. Because what happens is you got to remove the line or break the concrete so the water does drain. And that's they right. need a permit for that, but they don't need one to build. It's the opposite way around. I'm a little bit confused on this.
Yeah. You know? And sorry, Councillor. And so, I mean, the first thing I'll do is ask my inspectors to drop by your property this afternoon just to make sure that you have the proper approvals. but so what would happen if you did install a pool in today's world? You would get approval from of the lock rating from a development engineering. Then you would come to us for the approval of the enclosure as per the bylaw, do the installation, send somebody out to do the inspection. And so in today's world, that would be the case that, you know, you would follow an approval system to do the installation. And then likewise, when you decommission, we would ask that you follow the same thing. It is, you're right, if nobody knows it's there and you do it, then, you know, then it happens. And that's not unlike many situations where you have homeowners that may build a deck in their backyard without, you know, coming to us for approvals first. It's one of those situations that if you don't see it and you don't know about it, then there's not much that our inspectors can do until, you know, it is discovered or until an issue pops up down the road that, in fact, the liner wasn't properly removed or that the grading was altered and has adversely affected the drainage of the neighbor to the rear.
Right. But what do you mean by enclosure?
So every pool that's installed in the city of Brampton requires a fence to be erected around the perimeter of the pool so that, you know, to maintain the safety of the community, you know, children that don't live in the house can't wander into the pool accidentally. So we do have a requirement that every pool be fenced in.
Yeah, with a 4-foot fence, I understand it's a pool fence where you can have a wood fence 6 feet high, but that's only for the fence. But how do we determine if there was a pool or not? That's like, so all these pools that have been around until now, like, we don't need a permit. We only need the, I know we have no jurisdiction on the electrical, but the gas, you still need a license for the gas to be hooked up and the digging. So when you're digging, we need a grading permit where we're doing somewhere, but I'm okay to go out in my backyard and dig an 8-foot pool and start digging with no permit. Just a pool. Well, forget about the fence. I'm talking about the pool. I'm digging 8-9 feet deep now, and it's all in a pool.
No, we would certainly require a permit for that.
Oh, there is a permit because
that's right.
Okay.
Because we do call them pool permits, but they, and the reason I say that is, you know, the construction of the pool itself isn't regulated by the building code, but our bylaws regulate how the fence is constructed around the pool. But part of that process in this bylaw is that we have approval of the grading in order to proceed with that construction. And so this is one of those scenarios where the building division is the gatekeeper of the pool enclosure bylaw. And so a permit system is required, but it is a permit system separate from the Ontario Building Code regime. Very similar to to the registration system. It's handled by the building department, and officially the process is a bylaw process that is enacted outside of the jurisdiction of the Ontario Building Code.
Okay, thank you. Got my answers.
Okay, you're great welcome.
Thank you,
Councillor Fortini. This takes us to public question period.
Through you, Mr. Mayor, there is a question that has come in. It's in regard to the update during the COVID-19 regarding wearing face masks in transit vehicles and in buildings. It's from Andrea Steenberg. I'm concerned with council's interest in making facial masks mandatory on transit and in buildings and facilities. Many of our population suffer from asthma and other respiratory type debilitations, not to mention claustrophobia. These residents have been told repeatedly not to wear face masks because of medical, physical, and mental issues. Will the City of Brampton refuse service to people who are unable to wear masks?
A great question. The medical officer of health has said there are some people that for breathing problems like asthma can't wear a mask, and accommodations should be made. And I imagine we will continue to make those accommodations, obviously when there's a reasonable medical reason to do so. Any other questions? No. That takes us to bylaws. We're now at the portion of the meeting dealing with adoption of city bylaws. To give effect to council decisions made at this meeting, I have a motion moved by Councillor Santo, seconded by Councillor Vicente, to approve the bylaws.
So, Mr. Mayor, just to add, bylaw 91 was added to the agenda by Councillor Pelleschi and approved as part of consent. Yep. There is now an added bylaw 92-2020, which is the bylaw to lift the parking restrictions. So that would be included in this motion as well.
Okay, and they're all on the screen. This is once again moved by Councillor Santo, seconded by Councillor Vicente. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. This takes us to, we already dealt with a closed section. That's done. Takes us to confirming bylaw. Moved by Councillor Santo, seconded by Councillor Vicente to approve the confirming bylaw to confirm the proceedings and decisions of this meeting. Any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. That takes us to adjournment. Our next meeting is Wednesday, June 10th at 1 p.m., followed to our meeting on June 24th. I have a motion moved by Councillor Fortini, seconded by Councillor Williams, to adjourn today's special meeting. Are there any objections? Hearing none, the motion carries. Thank you for your consideration of this discussion today and for everyone following the physical distancing guidance of public health. The meeting is adjourned.